السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن نبينا محمدا صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد, dear respected brothers and sisters, let us continue the story of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, the best of the second best. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was a very noble person. He did not want to humiliate himself whatsoever. He doesn't accept, he used to refuse to accept from the khulafa when they used to send money. They said that once one of the khulafa sent him 30,000 dirhams or dinars, he refused it. He wants to be self-sufficient. And he, in fact, he had a number of statements where he said that Talib al-Ilm should be self-sufficient and he should not humiliate himself before others. He had some money that he used to what? To invest with others in order to have a source of income for him. He had a very amazing story. He is known for that story. The story when he gave his daughter to one of his students as a wife. This story goes like this. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was teaching, and in his circle there was a person, a pious person, a student whose name is Kuthayr ibn Abi Wada'a. This Kuthayr ibn Abi Wada'a, one time he missed the circle of his Sheikh Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab. He missed it for a number of days. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab noticed this. When Kuthayr came back, he said, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab told him, "Where have you been?" He said, "My wife died and I was busy taking care of or processing the funeral." So Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was very sad because of this. Sa'id al-Musayyab had a daughter. And at that time, the Khalifa was Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. The Khalifa wanted to have the daughter of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab as a wife for his son al-Walid. So he approached Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab and he proposed that al-Walid to get married to the daughter of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab refused. He refused to give his daughter in marriage to who? To the son of the Khalifa, al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik, subhanallah. Now, if a person was approached by the king to give his wife in marriage to the son of the king, would he refuse? And listen, brothers and sisters, at that time, the Khulafa of Bani Umayyah, they were good people. In fact, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, some scholars considered him as one of the Fuqaha of Medina before he became the Khalifa, one of the jurists of Medina. And Marwan ibn al-Hakam as well was considered one of the Tabi'een and one of the scholars. So they were not bad people, they were not evil people. Yes, they had some mistakes. So they were having good qualities. Yet Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab refused. So imagine now if there is a king and we don't see righteous kings or leaders as we used to see in the past. So, or as we read about kings and leaders in the past. So if a person was approached to give his daughter in marriage to one of those leaders or to the future leader, of course everyone would rush to this because he will say, oh, for sure she will be the queen, she will be like princes, she will be living a very luxurious life, we will be living a luxurious life accordingly. But is this the criteria for marriage? This is the question. Is this the criteria for marriage? Now, What is the criteria for doing anything? As we all say, brothers and sisters, Allah Jalla wa Ala says in the Quran, كل نفس ذائقة الموت فمن زحزح عن النار وأدخل الجنة فقد فاز. The one who was saved from the hellfire and admitted to Jannah, he is really successful. So the real criteria for anything we do in this life is what lies with the Akhirah, success in the Akhirah. Now, when we talk about this, people don't remember this when they are talking about the one proposing to marry their daughters. They immediately think of the dunya. They want, please listen to this, they want a pious person, not because this pious person will help their daughters to go to Jannah. No. They say that the pious person will be what? The pious person will be a nice person, a nice husband to their daughters. He will not give her hard time. So the aim of marrying a pious person is what? Is the dunya again, is not the akhirah. I hope that this matter is clear. While anything that we do in this dunya should have an aim with the akhirah and should not have a worldly matter aim. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab refused to give his daughter in marriage to the son of the Khalifa, who is likely to be another Khalifa in the future, and he did. He became Al-Walid ibn Abdul Malik, became the Khalifa. So, what happened next? As we said, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab had a circle, and within that circle there was a student. His name is Kuthayr ibn Abi Wada'a. Kuthayr ibn Abi Wada'a, he missed the circle for a number of days. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib came to him when he came back to attend it. He said, where were you? Kuthayr ibn Abi Wada'a said, well, I lost my wife. She passed away and I was busy taking care of the janazah, etc. So Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib thought, and then he said, do you want to get married? Then Kuthayr said, of course I do, but who is going to, what? To marry me. Who is going to allow me to marry their daughters? I am a poor person. I don't have money. I only have 2 dirhams. Who would accept me to marry their daughters while I'm in that devastated situation? Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib said, I do. He said, what? He said, I do. Then immediately he conducted the nikah. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib conducted the nikah immediately. Now, here there is an issue. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib did not consult his daughter. For sure, he knows that his daughter would agree. Otherwise, he is a jurist. He is a jurist, or he was a jurist. He knows that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَا تُنْكَحُوا الْبِكْرُ حَتَّى تُسْتَأْذَن. The bikr, the virgin, should not be married to someone without her permission. So he knows this, but he knows that his daughter would accept this. And that's why some scholars said, if the father knows that his daughter is interested in this marriage or interested in this man or would be interested in this, then he doesn't need to consult her directly, and this is as if he consulted her and took her consent to marry this person. So Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib told him, ala barakatillah, and he married him, his daughter. Then Kuthayr said, I went home, and there was nothing in my home, nothing at all, except like a big dish that I use to eat, or a big plate that I use for food and to eat. So he said, when I was sitting there, all of a sudden I heard that the door was knocking. I was surprised. I thought of anyone in the world except Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, because they said that he has never visited someone. He was just moving from his home to the masjid, and sometimes he would visit his daughter. So, when I opened the door, Kuthayr says, when I opened the door, I was shocked to see Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. And then Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib said, Well, Kuthayr, assalamu alaykum. Said, alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah. He said, well, I thought of your situation and I thought that it is not good for you to stay this night by yourself. I thought that as you got married, I should bring your wife to you. And then he moved a little bit and his daughter was with him. She was behind him. And he took her and he let her enter my house. I was astonished, Kuthayr said. I was astonished. She fell down because she was so shy. The door was closed and I was shocked. So I went on the roof and I called for my neighbors. They said, what's wrong with you? I said, please go and call my mom. They said, what is happening? He said, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab gave me his daughter as wife. They said, what? You got married to the daughter of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab? He said, yes, by Allah, come to me. You will see her in my house. So his mother came very quickly and they said, wallahi, it is haram for you to touch her. She said, haram for you. Of course, haram here is not shar'i haram. But she is, as if she is telling him, don't touch her whatsoever. So she took my wife. He said she took her and she calmed her down and she's starting to dress her properly and to even to put makeup, etc. and to prepare her for the marriage. After 3 days, the daughter got ready for marriage and they brought her to me. And when I saw her, she was the most beautiful lady. And then I consummated the marriage with her and we lived together. A few days later, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab came to him. In fact, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab came to him before this and he brought him an amount of money. They are telling me that we are coming to the end of this segment. Inshallah, we will continue after the break. Assalamu alaikum.
Yathrib. This was its name before the Prophet, peace be upon him, arrived in it.
This place is called Masjid Al-Fatih. Here the Prophet ﷺ came and he entered.
But soon afterwards, it became known as Al-Madinah.
On our right side, we have the Prophet's mosque. Immediately, we can see the Green Dome. Here now on, it's a place definitely the Messenger and his companions has walked on. Here, Islam was made at the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Visit the city of the Prophet with Dr. Muhammad Saeed this Ramadan only on Huda TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, brothers and sisters. We just discussed the story of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, his daughter, and the one who got married to her, Kuthayr ibn Abi Wada'a. We said that he offered his daughter, and Kuthayr married his daughter. He was a very poor person. And then when he got married to her, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab once visited him immediately after the marriage, after he sent his daughter to him. And he gave him an amount of money. And he said, what is this? Why didn't you ask me to come? He said, no, I thought that you need some money to support your family and to support the wedding. And so he gave him the money. What kind of teacher is this? He gave him his daughter and he gave him money. Why? Because the criteria is, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab knows that this person is the best person for. Please listen to this, brothers and sisters. This person is the best for the akhirah of his daughter, not the dunya of his daughter. I would like all of you to remember this, that when you want to accept a proposal given by any brother, then think of the akhirah of your daughter. Is this the best for her akhirah or not? That is the criteria. They said that during that period, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, when he refused the proposal of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, Abdul Malik ibn Marwan threatened him to prison him. According to one narration, in fact, he put him in jail for some time. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was a very hard person, a very strong person. One time, when he was in Medina, he was not happy with the khilafah of Abdullah ibn Zubayr, nor the khilafah of al-Sham. But he kept quiet. Internally, he was making dua against Bani Marwan because of the injustice that used to take place. You know, the dispute at that time between Bani Marwan in al-Sham and Abdullah ibn Zubayr in al-Hijaz was confusing for some people. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, at that time, he never accepted Abdullah ibn Zubayr as the Khalifa, nor he accepted Bani Marwan as the Khalifa. In fact, there was an incident where Abdullah ibn Zubayr wanted Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab to give the allegiance or the bay'ah to the wali on Medina. His name was Jabir ibn al-Aswad. So Jabir ibn al-Aswad asked Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab to give the oath of allegiance to him on behalf of Abdullah ibn Zubayr. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab was angry and he said, no, I will never give this oath unless all Muslims agree that Abdullah ibn Zubayr is the Khalifa. I don't want to discuss the opinion of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab because some other scholars used to consider Abdullah ibn Zubayr a Khalifa at a certain time. Some of them used to accept both of them. In fact, very, very few scholars considered both of them as Khalifa in the same time. In fact, to be honest with you, many scholars disputed this and they said that, no, the scholars at that time who kept quiet, they did not accept both of them to be Khalifa at the same time. But they were avoiding the fitna. And there was a consensus from scholars at that time, the Tabi'een, that one of them is the Khalifa, not both at the same time. And this goes with the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that when two Khalifas are appointed or given bay'ah, then kill one of them. Why? Because we have to have one Khalifa only, not two Khalifa simultaneously. Anyway, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab had his view to just keep away from this. He was not happy with this. He was not happy with that. And he kept away from this. When Jabir ibn al-Aswad said to him, you have to give the bay'ah, he said, no, unless all Muslims give bay'ah. However, he was trying to avoid fitna. One time a person came to him and he said to him, are you with people of Sham or are you with Abdullah ibn Zubayr? He said, why are you asking? Just keep away from me. Also, when a person came to him and he said to him, now the Khalifa is who? Is Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. The Khalifa is Abdul Malik ibn Marwan and the matter has been established that the Khalifa is Abdul Malik ibn Marwan. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, of course, he had no choice but to accept. And as far as I remember, no one disputed the Khilafa of Abdul Malik ibn Marwan at a later stage. We said that Abdul Malik ibn Marwan continued as a Khalifa for almost 20 years. So at the last time, he was the only Khalifa, or at the last period of his long period, he was the only Khalifa. So they said that Abdul Malik ibn Marwan is asking you to give bay'ah to two of his children, Sulaiman and Al-Walid. Sulaiman and Al-Walid. We said that when Abdul Malik ibn Marwan died, the one who took over was his eldest son, Al-Walid. Then after Al-Walid died, Sulaiman ibn Abdul Malik was the Khalifa. Abdul Malik ibn Marwan assigned both of them to be the deputies after him. When they came to Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib and asked him to give bay'ah to both of them, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib abstained and he said, we are not allowed to give bay'ah to two people simultaneously. We should give bay'ah to one of them only. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, as we said, he was a very great scholar. They said that he never heard something and forget it. In fact, one of the narrators said that one time I came to him and then he started to ask me about my family and my my father, my grandfather and my other grandfather. And he said, oh, yes, yes, I remember that your grandfather came in that year, long time ago, and he asked me about this and that and this and that. Subhanallah, he remembered the person and the questions he asked him. They said that he never heard something and forgot it. Ibn Umar, when people ask Ibn Umar a question, he said, why are you asking me while you have Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib between us? Go and ask Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. He is well acquainted with the qada of Umar, the qada of Abu Bakr, the qada of Uthman. And they said, in fact, the most acquainted person with the qada, the judgment of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, was Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, was not Abdullah ibn Umar. Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, he had had a circle to teach knowledge and to disseminate knowledge. And he continued doing this until radiyallahu ta'ala anhu died in year 94 or year 95. That year is known as the year of that year is known as the year of fuqaha, the year of jurists. Why? Because they said that there were number of scholars who died in that year, either year 94 or year 95. Among those people who died in that year, they said in the beginning, Ali ibn al-Husayn ibn Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu died in that year. Also, al-Hasan al-Basri died in that year. And also, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib died in that year. And some others. They called that year as the year of al-Fuqaha. Rahimahullahu ta'ala, he was a distinguished scholar. And he, radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, left a lot of legacy. They said that Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, rahimahullah, had a distinguished ijtihad and has some unique opinions in some matters. They were discussing whether he went against ijma' in certain masail or he was not going against ijma'. He had certain opinions regarding talaq. He had certain opinions regarding other matters related to tahara. And he had some opinions regarding some financial contracts. We can't get into this subject now because we are running out of time. And this takes us out of the remit of this discussion. Also, they discussed whether Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib heard from Umar ibn al-Khattab. And they were discussing whether the ahadith that Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib narrated are heard by him from Umar ibn al-Khattab. In another word, he heard Umar ibn al-Khattab narrating these ahadith and he did not just do irsal. Means, qala Umar, but he did not hear the ahadith from Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Anyway, this is just a technical discussion, maybe for some academics. We don't have time to discuss it. Inshallah. Maybe in the future we might have another discussion about the life of Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib. But as far as this series is concerned, this will be, we will have the next episode as the final episode of this series. Inshallah, we will see you in the coming episode, which will be the final episode. Until then, we say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.